We'll start off this video with a bang. Open a mail up today. Gerald Champ sent me a bunch of pictures. This is the nose construction of his new ship, which has a Sato 80. Now, one of the things I'm real excited about, Gerald has offered to let me run the motor, do a little comparison, maybe put it in the tradition, take a file to it, saw it in half, put it in a hot dog roll, and eat it. Gerald, you send me that motor, you may never get it back. Anyway, this is his new ship. I like the airbox. He was a little concerned about having room for the tank. Now, because on this video, we're going to actually make up the crutch out of carbon fiber. It may be, there'll be some information on here you can even use. One of the things we've never done yet is use a carbon crutch in a wood fuselage. But that's coming, and it's coming soon because we're going to be making all new molds. The bottom of the fuselage, and we got to look at a lot of Gerald's handiwork in the stuff that he sent to Mike Costello. Really nice stuff, Gerald. And I still have your P-51 Al Rabe giant Mustang fuselage. Everybody that comes over there still oodles over it. Anyway, this is similar to what we're going to do to Mike Kajeski's plane. Mike is out on a giant construction job now, making thousands and thousands of dollars so he can take the whole summer and go flying as my test pilot for no pay at all. Anyway, this ship has an 8-inch or 8 3/4-inch nose, but what's going to save it is that it's a wide fuselage, and probably he'll wind up with a custom-made special size gas tank. And we're going to be real soon, in fact, probably within a week, be starting to make, Jimmy's got the tooling almost finished, for the carbon fiber fuel tanks. But they're not going to be appropriate for a four-stroke, because what we want on a four-stroke is a short, fat tank, and we don't concern ourselves with the 2-4 brake at all. Anyway, that would be a nice place to put the Z-tron, Jer, if you decide to go for that. Beautiful construction. And if you notice on one of the previous videos how Joe Adamusco handled this deal with the needle valve. Another thing I heard is Paul Winter has figured out reversing the carburetor and said that made the linkage a lot easier to hook up, at least his little gizmo linkage. We're going to look at that. And by the way, the 91 and the 72, it looks like the intakes interchange, so that would give us a variation in height, maybe for trim and tanks. More to come. Jer, I have to tell you, I can't wait to get my hands on your motor here. Anyway, let's start working on this crutch. It's time. Now, last year, as part of the Miss Ashley project, we made two molds. One of the molds is still out in California, being used to make a carbon crutch. I still haven't got it back. Doesn't matter, though, because what we're going to do an all-new one for the Typhoon.
I always save all the plugs and of course all the molds so that I can remake parts. In this case, if somebody needs to borrow it, use it, and I need it in a hurry, I can just remake the mold in one day. The clutch system on this plane, I think, just worked out perfectly. The only variation we're going to make is it's going to have to fit a wider fuselage and, of course, a wider motor. But we're going to try to make it as universal as possible, a little bit different design. Let me do a quick little storyboard to show what I have in mind.
Some of the things we learned, among others, last year about making crutches were that they were very light and very strong, a very practical way to make a part. Another thing we learned is you don't need blind nuts. We learned that the hard way. We spent a whole couple of days trying to figure a way to put blind nuts in. You can drill and tap the carbon. It's lasted a whole season without ever having to retighten the engine. One of the biggest features, never ever absorbs oil. And even if you have to repair it, it's not an oil-soaked mess. It can be repaired. Another thing, it's an easy part to mold. Great if you want to introduce or add to your modeling skills. You want to find a part that's easy to make and will instantly be in a couple of days. You can have it in your crutch, in your next fuselage, your next plane, whatever. A great introductory part. Another thing is what I use it for. I use up all my carbon scraps. All the little pieces of tow and the little pieces of extra matting and weave that I have, I can pack them all into that crutch mold. Now, one thing we benefited from is we had excellent, excellent motor runs in Miss Ashley for the whole season last year. One of the things that's really appealing to a lot of people is once you make the mold, or even if you don't make your own mold, see, our mold is out on loan right now. It doesn't matter. You can borrow Wendy's mold and make your own part. Quick to make. Really, really one of the most practical parts. And like I said, we will be, the next possible chance, fitting one of these into a wood fuselage. It's easy, in my estimation, to adapt this to any design, any model. But it would be especially helpful if you were making a similar model or the same model over and over again, because then you could use the same mold over and over again. And what would determine that is the width of the fuselage. If every model you make is going to say, let's say, have a PA61, once you make that dimension to fit the motor, you're done. And once you make a carbon fiber phone, you never have to answer it.
I don't think so.
Going to design up your own crutch, and of course once you make a fuselage shell, once you have a mold, the only other part you need are a couple of bulkheads and a crutch, an appropriate crutch. Or if you can beg, borrow, or steal somebody else's molds, and I anticipate that that would even be easier. But anyway, you want to make, this is important, you want to make the crutch to fit the widest motor. Because one of the things I never like to do is at the end of retrofitting or putting other motors in is cut all this motor mount material away. I really don't like to. Now, we're not going to use a square shape. We're going to use kind of a little bit different technology to do this. But I want to get the bolts somewhere near the middle, or I don't want the bolts right on the edge. And because we're going to try to make this a very universal mount that fits a lot of different engines, and the biggest of them, by the way, is the Sato 91. Probably the smallest one is down to a jet size. But I want to have one crutch. But I'll always make the crutch off the widest motor, and it's the dimension here. This is the critical dimension of the widest motor you want to use. Once you do that, retrofitting a smaller motor in, you can even do it with those clamp things that we've used on many planes. That works great. A lot of different ways of doing it. You can actually tap the carbon. So to maximize the possibilities for this plane, we want to be, and we even want to try that laser in here, we want to have kind of a universal motor mount crutch. Design criteria is, once we have the shell, and what I do is I take the motor, make the crutch, make a dummy balsa wood crutch, and I fit this in position with the spinner attached to the motor. So I get the spinner attachment right, the attachment point. I get this dimension right, this dimension right, and then I need to measure down and make sure this is equal, otherwise the motor is going to be in one way or the other. But the first thing I need to do is just with a piece of quarter inch balsa is measure off. Now it just happens. I'm a person, I take pride in never wasting anything. But that the first fuselage we made that cracked in the back, well, we're going to use it now. We're going to use it as a dummy so we can do all our test fitting. I just need to use the nose section of it, and I can use to do all the test fitting, cutting, grinding, shaping, everything in there, because they'll both be the same in the very end. So having that extra fuselage now is a real handy point in being able to make this part up. Learn some really, really important things. If you're going to make a shell and if you're going to make a crutch or a crutch in a wood fuselage, you're going to need some of this material. And this is available from CST in California. This is post, I shouldn't say this, it's glue that's made to do bonding of parts that are already cured, or in my case, post-cured. It's not really the right terminology, but we're not having English lessons here. The point is, this glue is made to do what's called secondary bonding. And even if you glue a carbon crutch into a wood fuselage, you're going to want to use this glue. I would highly suggest you use this. You're also going to want to sand any surface that's going to get glued with 80 grit paper. It's got to be rough. The rougher the better. If you're trying to glue two pieces of glass together, there's not much bonding surface. If you're trying to glue two washboards together, you double, triple, or quadruple the amount of bonding surface. The more sanding scratches you can put in there, the better of a bond you're going to have. The more sanding scratches. And every company I've ever talked to about this highly recommends 80 grit paper to roughen the surfaces, clean it with M600, and do the secondary bonding. With it's called ProSet 175-273. So this is the biggest of the motors that we anticipate using. It's the Sato 91. And the first thing I need to do, I want to get a piece of balsa wood and make just a complete dummy size crutch, so I can establish where this location is going to be in the airplane. Remember, I need to know this dimension for nose. Actually, the first thing I have to do is put the spinner on, because I have to reference from the spinner back how far the crutch won't go all the way to the spinner. I can leave it maybe an inch in front of this. Our dummy shell, the one that didn't work out the way we wanted. The first thing I want to do is cut this off, because I want to use this as my reference point. That reference point is going to establish the height that I need to establish. Well, I need to do it on the good shell from the doubler, but I can pretty much tell from the spinner fit roughly what height that's going to be at.
But this is going to be the actual end of the nose moment right here. But I want the crutch to go back maybe another inch or so. So that becomes my mark. Actually, we'll make a 9-inch crutch and let it go back into the fuselage another inch, past where the bulkhead for the wing is going to be. Now what I did, I put a piece of duct tape on here just to hold this in its dimension roughly. And now I need to measure this area in here and get a piece of quarter-inch wood just to roughly fit in there. Again, this is kind of a crude way to do it, but it seems to work. And it's something pretty much anybody can do. You can kind of just get a rough idea here. And this is the roughest. See, I can always add pieces to it. I can always take pieces away. Just want to get a rough, very rough dimension on a piece of scrap wood. Then I can transpose that onto my actual part.
Trying to do is get that curve up in the nose just right. I think that's doing it real. Probably the crudest way possible.
This is all rough. Now, none of this is final. I just laid out the dimensions and a center. I want to leave the last inch or so unattached to the fuselage at this point in time. And it looks like I've got, a relatively tight fit, and that's what I'm looking for. I'll make sure I have some kind of a radius back here. Oh, I see that the carburetor hits. Isn't that something? I didn't realize. Ooh, look at that. Yeah, we have to take that into account. We can't have... Well, that's certainly going to be a nuisance. Not really. What we'll do is make sure we put an impression in there. We have to allow for that. Make sure I do is, see, I know I need to leave that accessible. I'll just bring the first former on the crutch further back. Hey, good thing I saw that. That's how much it actually interferes with it, too. I use one of the poly rods because we want to try to maintain, as I'm making this, some kind of final fit around the engine that I'm going to be happy with. And we're going to have to put a finish on this before we actually make the mold, so may as well right in the very beginning. If I see, I can still get in there. See, this is the part, because I haven't designed this, I'm designing it as I go along. Little things like the carburetor hitting something, this is totally new stuff. This is not like when you do a Jet 60 or a PA or whatever. And you notice certain clearances, like on a pipe ship, you have to make room for the header and make sure heat gets out of there. Well, on these, there's other things you have to check for. The next thing I did, I just tack glued this down to a piece of 64th plywood on a flat surface. Just letting the CA kick off, then I'm going to trim this off. And that'll give me a little integrity while I cut this piece out. Now, next step, I'm just going to dremel this all off and sand it smooth. I'm trying to get this a smooth transition in here. Step, I want to cut this whole horseshoe out, then I can lay out my center bracing. So I've got this oversized in every dimension, so I can do a little fine tuning on it when I get the actual part. Now at this point it's pretty flimsy, and I've got to watch that I maintain the integrity here when I lay this out. Alright, I measured out the front, and this part here we're not going to really need. Now the next thing I need to do is establish a base plate for this. It's a piece of furniture from a garage sale, or from no sale, from just dumpster day. This is now going to be my base plate. It's relatively straight, and I'm going to tack glue this down as the first step. What I did when I tack glued this down, I just let this piece stay in here as my reference. So I know I haven't made it spread out or spread in. 64th plywood has a primary grain. This grain is going in this direction. So what happens is it bends real easy one way, doesn't like to bend that way. So I want to go with the grain going basically straight up and down. I want to strip off a whole bunch of pieces here. And I'm just using this as a... Nothing real special here, because I want to put edging on. This is about the only thing I'm going to be able to do tonight. But notice that I have the grain in this dimension, so I can bend it. Trick on this plywood is just, this will help us in a big way. I just want to score it. Well, I could really cut it right through, it wouldn't even matter, but even just scoring it. So I want to get long strips. I want to have a relatively straight edge. Do is, yeah, just tack glued that in. What I'm hoping this will do is give me a nice edge that will be easy to finish, because I want all nice smooth edges on this mold. This I hope will give me, I'm just going to
tack it right in place. But the plywood will give me kind of a finished edge. And I've taken into account, I want to make this a little bit of a tight fit. In fact, I'm going to add another piece on this because I want to have a tight fit so that when I fit the smaller engines in, I have as much material up there as I possibly can have. But as opposed to taking balsa wood and trying to put a finish on it, just easier to line it with 64th plywood. Around the whole part tonight, and I guess that's all I'm going to get time to do tonight. That's about it. Once I have this whole edge, I'm going to put this aside for the night. It's time, and I love working on these projects, but I even love supper time even more. So when we come back to this tomorrow, this will be ready to do a final finish, fill in the ribs. I reckon we'll probably be able to make the rubber mold tomorrow if everything goes right. Now what I want to do today, I want to get extra CA around all of the edges, just let it fill in all the gaps and edges. Then I'm going to sand this part down before I put the ribs in. See, because it'll just be easier to get the sanding done at this point in time. I'll let the CA fill in everything. The CA will act as my finish on this. I won't even have to finish it. And hopefully today we can finish this and get the rubber mold drying. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to get a micrometer. I want to make this a tighter fit. I want to make sure this fits the 72 and the laser also. So I'll make it smaller than it has to really be, and then I'll do the last little cutting out when I actually decide which engine's going to go in here. I want to make this on a minus side because this is the 91. This is the biggest of the motors. This is really 150. I want to make sure I have it this right on both sides. It's 1580. Now you can see the difference here. This is the 72. Look at the difference. This is 1390. Quite a bit of difference. Now, unless you really look at them close, it isn't the difference in the weight that's a problem. It's the difference in the width, because this is a much longer stroke motor. 91, of course, is a longer stroke motor. So I want to put a little bit of extra material inside that crutch to allow for this. This is the engine we're doing. We're working with Mike's fuselage and crutch here. He's out on a construction job. While he's out there, I'm trying to get a lot of my little details done, too. Let's see, this is, actually what's going to happen is this: the laser will fit exactly where the 72 will fit. And I'm very curious about this. Actually, the laser is even smaller than the Sato in that dimension. Every time I look at this engine, I just think, wow. But we have all the choices, and that's part of what we're trying to do is to make this crutch adaptable to as many choices as possible. See, on a laser, what you could do, if you really wanted to, if you were doing a laser up, you could line up the front and just drill these motor mounts with the holes for the engine you were replacing. So that's kind of a neat option. I wanted to see how much more I need to add. Actually, one more piece will be plenty. So the next thing I want to do is dress. See, it'll be easier to do the sanding on this now than after I put the ribs in. So I want to get as much of the sanding done. You can see there's little lips on here from where I put the extra CA. I'm just going to real carefully dress this off with a block. Just easier with this piece here.
That's all these little inside areas that, in fact,
maybe this would be easier.
Yeah. We're not really going to see these in the final product. Just make the mold a little nicer. And it's that corner edge where the base meets the part that's always a little bit of a pain to get right. Just to play it safe, I want to put a little bit of extra material in here. What the thing this will allow me to do is, first off, I can grind out the original part for the 91. But if somebody wants a crutch and they don't want to use a 91, I don't want to have to make another. You know, see, Elliot may, we're anticipating making a few of these. What will happen is somebody that wants to use a 72 is going to want that extra material in there. So I'm going to just add a piece of 64th plywood. The easiest way to get an extra piece around the curve, if you start gluing it by hand, it gets real difficult. But this is a good trick. You can hold it in place and just tack the corners first. And it obviously gives you a nice curve too. The first thing is always do the corners first. Let's see if we got this. Now the idea of the sandpaper keeps it from sticking. Glue typically doesn't stick to sandpaper, typically. That means it'll do it for us. Okay, so we'll get this side in. Make sure this corner, this'll just give us that from this mold I can grind out a little more material and still make another one that'll be a tight fit on a 72 or a 70 without having to make a new mold. It's kind of like, really not sure what that technology really is. Now, once that's in, of course, it's a very easy thing to just... And notice that I'm making the motor, the crutch for the biggest motor. I'm not making this for the smallest one and then trying to gut it all up. And all the retrofits, that's the biggest pain of all, is when you have no motor mounts to work with. When you're all done with a plane, you want to put a motor in and you don't have enough motor mounts. You can always grind some away, but boy, is it difficult to add some. So anyway, this may give us the option of using the same thing for more than one project too. I thought I'd mention something, because one of the things we're trying to take advantage of here, when you're making a thin fuselage plane, you really need gigantic motor mounts and you need all kinds of things in between. Because here's what's really happening. Here's the wing, here's the fuselage, and the motor, the torque of the motor is trying to do this. What you're really trying to do with a nose construction is connect the motor to the wing and build a torque tube. Well, I don't know what the right term in engineering is, but if you have a thin, the smaller you make this, let's even go to, let's say you wanted to make this real, like a profile. Okay. Well, if this is a profile, you've got to have this much more material to build a torque tube. The bigger you make this, I mean, let's go to the extreme. Let's say you were making a GB. Well, boy, you could get away with very thin wall construction. The bigger the diameter, the bigger the outside skin is, the less thick it has to be, but of course the more skin there is. So there's a compromise, and the compromise we arrived at with the Typhoon was, we're basically going to use the same mounts we used, the same thickness as Miss Ashley, but the fuselage is about a half inch wider, well not a half inch, maybe a quarter of an inch, and it's going to be a wider torque tube. Think of that torque tube. What the motor is running, it wants to do this. It wants to twist. You just connect any two objects, and what you're trying to do is connect them together. That's what the crutch is doing. But if you make a real thin, narrow fuselage, you better have gigantic, well-engineered motor mounts. As you make the fuselage thicker and thicker, up to the point, let's say, like a scale GB could have a 64th plywood fuselage would be enough. As you get down here, maybe this would have to be a 16th, this would have to be an 8th, this would have to be solid to get the same amount of torque tube effect. Anyway, but that's what we're trying to do here. We're trying to engineer up. Now, we know the one from Miss Ashley worked, so we're just engineering it up with the mounts a little bit further apart, knowing that the skin will be the same, the crutch will be the same, but in this case, we have a much bigger motor. So we're hoping we've guessed right, and if not, you know the consequences. We're going to be making another fuselage. The cross brace is at a 3 pieces of 64th plywood. The reason for that, instead of using balsa wood, is I'll get a nice finish on this side. Be a lot easier when I go to finish the mold if I'm working on plywood instead of working on balsa wood. And I wanted it to be a little less than a 16th. This is 45 thousandths altogether. Measured off my little location parts, and they're going to be 1 inch apart. And the back end of this is going to get cut off or tapered, but I'll fill this with ribs right now just to make a relatively stiff, easy to work on part. I'm being real careful to get a glue seam in the back here that none of the molding rubber will leak underneath. I'm working these corners and edges. Every time I get a piece, I want to make sure that's a sealed, that the rubber is going to get down in there, that there's a seal. Now you notice what we've done, and this is probably a good idea to do no matter what kind of a deal you're working on. We're going to have an 8-inch nose, so I don't know that we're going to use maybe 9 inches of this, 10 inches, I don't know. But by making it super long, what I've also allowed for the fact that if I can run some of this back over the wing, that'll be nice. We don't know if that's going to fit right in there. The other thing too, if somebody wants to adapt this, now, because General Champ has an 80, I mean, just think of the possibility. 80 will drop right in this crutch. You could make this size fuselage, and if in his case, he has an 8 3/4 nose. Well, then he could use up to this. See, once you're going to invest the time in making a mold, you may as well make it as universal as possible. Now, we've got this so it'll fit 72s and 80s and 90s, 70s. And we've also got we're going to just cut off what we don't use. We've also got the option of using it on longer and longer noses, if that becomes appropriate. And we don't know, we don't even know what next year's project is. Maybe next year's project will be something with a 9-inch nose or a 7-inch nose. But by having this extra long, we've covered all our bases. Now, the next thing to do on this is I got to take and block sand this all down, finish in all these edges. I'll do that all off camera and get this prepped so that we can make the mold.
Final thing here is I've been working on this for quite a while. Try to get this. Oh, don't you love that sound? To get this perfectly flat. Now what I'm going to do with this is, makes me crazy. I'm going to spray on a coat of Brodex. Oh, I can't believe that sound. Let it dry and then
be very careful about getting in all the corners, all the edges, because I don't want the molding rubber to go down underneath.
And too, the block is good for us doing this edge. Now I had thought of a way of putting a serration on that edge and letting it pick up right in the mold, but I just feel like with the rubber mold, it'll tear the mold apart eventually if I do that. So we'll have to go with something like this. Anyway, we're closing in on having this done. It's the second day. We'll pour the rubber to the, well, it's probably going to be 3 days altogether before we have a working part.
But we've got so many other projects to work on, it doesn't even matter. And she's ready for the primer. Now, believe it or not, the snow is finally melting. Come on, puppy. And one of the things I had a problem with, there was a lot of fish eyes on the furniture. I guess whatever this piece of furniture was at one time, somebody waxed it. But nothing that a couple of coats of Brodak primer. I'm just putting one coat on right after another. You get three, four, five coats on, doesn't matter. I can sand it a little bit between coats if it looks like it's rough. There's a couple of rough spots on here. Let that dry, and actually it's warm enough out here, it can dry outside today. Tomorrow we'll be ready to lay up the mulch. Okay, we're back today and we're laying out, cutting all the cloth for all our little molding operations that go on every day. But I want to lay up the box, the relatively simple, make a balsa wood box, mix up the molding rubber that's going to go on here. You can see that this is because of the Brodak primer is not happy going over this varnish or whatever's on here. None of the defects in that are going to make any difference because they're not on the part. They're on the surface, and this is all going to get ground away. So rather than spend a lot of time trying to make this fancier than it has to be, what I'm going to do is just basically get the box made, mix the molding rubber, put a few minutes of this on camera because this is one of the operations. Again, this is one of the simple things that anybody, even low-level modeling skills, can make a rubber mold. It's not a difficult thing. It's a small challenge and a big reward. If you're looking to purchase molding rubber, this is the best company I've found. Their tech support is exceptional. They're willing to spend time on the phone with you. It's an exceptional company, and their molding rubber is one of the best. Now, the product, I've tried 910 and I've tried 912. I kind of like 912 just a little bit better. For our purposes, it seems to work very well. So give you a real nice, I don't know, a tech report or whatever, but it's a real simple product to use. It's a 10 to 1 by weight, PBWs. It's almost, I would say this, if you've never done any molding at all, this is a good product to start with. You'll get a release every time. And if you want to prolong the life of the mold, you can use a parting agent, silicone parting agent. They make the parting agent for the material. If you're only going to make one or two pulls, you don't need any parting agent at all. Any of the silicone rubbers, the first couple of pulls, they're fine. But as time goes by, they start to chunk out. You notice when you open the can, the rubber itself, there's a nice big label, I guess is the right word. It's 10 to 1. It's a good idea if you've never done it before. Practice with a small batch. Don't go mixing up more than you need. It's okay to mix a small batch. If it's not enough, mix another batch. 2 or 3 ounces at a time. You have plenty of working time. This is a really nice material to use if you're a modeler. You really can have good results with very little effort, very little technology. The catalyst is the part that you really don't want to get this on your hands. It's smelly. Not a real problem, but I like to use rubber gloves. I always have cuts all over my hands and stuff, so I really don't like getting this in. But again, you want to mix this very carefully, 10 to 1. In case you forget, it's always written right. It even, like aeropoxy light, it even tells you which is part B. First part is we need to make a box, maybe a quarter of an inch or half inch. Make it out of scrap balsa higher than this part because we're going to fill this with molding rubber. This is called a plug in the mold. And when we take the rubber part off, this is the part the impression of this will stay in there, and that'll be how we make the carbon fiber crutch. Is just set the stripper a quarter of an inch thicker than the material you need to run off a couple of pieces. Any old scrap will do. I just happen to have a piece of quarter inch here. And I just need to make a box. I like to leave about 3/4 to 1 inch on each side just for support. If it's just to not let the molding rubber creep out from underneath it as you make the box. That's the main objective. Again, be a little bit deeper than that part. Make sure the corners are sealed. If you're in doubt, you can run little pieces of duct tape or something around there. part that's a little, maybe the only tricky part of the whole thing is to stir it without ingesting and making air bubbles. Stir it nice and slow. They recommend a figure eight pattern. Get up against the wall and down at the bottom. Like any other thing that's a two-part mix, you need to just bite the bullet and spend a couple minutes mixing it if you want the best results possible.
My way of doing this is I weigh the cup, fill it to the point where I think it's going to be, get the total weight, in this case it's 480, and now add the 10% I have to deduct for the cup, which brings this to 470, and now add 47 grams into this, which is real easy to do. It's going to be 527. And now just add the catalyst and add it slowly, because once you pour it in, if it's too much, this, I try to get the last few drops until I see that scale start to move. I just use the cap, but it's a lot better than just adding catalyst and then having to reconfigure the whole thing or trying to dump it out. There it goes. Now if you can see that move, ooh, we got it right on the money. What a lucky dog he is. Okay, now, next trick in this is to stir this slowly. It takes about 5 minutes to stir it, and when you think it's stirred and it's all homogenized, stir it another 2 minutes. Any problems that I've ever seen people have or that I've talked to them about, one of two things: they didn't stir this enough. They saw it all kind of homogenized, and you can see the catalyst looks like water. I'm just trying to stir it real slow because I don't want to get any air bubbles. Your worst enemy is air bubbles. Also, this is a nice material. If you have a heating vent in the house, you can kind of get the material up to 72, 73 degrees instead of what my shop temperatures are about 62. Now see how long this is just one of the tricks. This is one of them. If you skip this trick, I don't know if it's a trick, just a way of doing it. Stir around the edges, because what you'll see is when the mold cures, you can actually feel areas where there's not enough catalyst. So you just keep, and there are several different kinds of molding rubber. Some require release agents. Silicone ones generally don't, unless you want a long mold life. Now in my case, I want infinite mold life. So what I try to do is every time I use the molds, give them a coat of that smooth-on release agent. Okay, it's starting to homogenize now. There's no point keeping this camera running, but we're going to give this a good 5 minutes of stirring. And when it looks like it's totally stirred, here it's starting to go now. What I'll do then is give it even another 2 minutes. Now this is pretty much what this looks like after a few minutes of stirring. Again, if you stir real quick, what happens is you wind up ingesting air and you have bubbles all through the mold. They kind of suggest this figure eight pattern and then going all along the corners. I know I go over this over and over again because I can't tell you how embarrassing it is to, you go down to the mold the day after you make it and it's cured in 80% of the parts, and there's big quarter-sized parts of it that aren't catalyzed. This is really an important part, and they kind of don't emphasize it on the instructions. Not as much as I would anyway. Okay, this is ready to pour. That's a nice viscosity. The idea is to pour it in all the corners and all the edges, so we don't want to trap any air. Other thing, really, I've found that it's better to try to get it in all the corners first, not just physically dump it in, since the idea is not to trap any air around, especially around the part that we're going to actually be doing. Now, even though the air bubbles do rise to the surface, it's still not, really burns you up when you get an air bubble somewhere. But there's really no reason. This is one of the easier parts to make.
again, if you're going to start a little molding program, you want to start with something easy that you know you're going to have good success at. Now see, I can see the air bubbles kind of coming up to the surface. I just do one little spot at a time until I have them all. They'll all rise up. Let's see if we can just get some around here now. Now see, in here it won't really matter. This looks like it's going to be a good pour now. If I don't have enough rubber, I'll just mix up another batch. Here's an example of what I'm looking for. This is what you want to get rid of right here. See those air bubbles pop? Well, if you can get rid of all of them early on, boy, you're way ahead of the game. And when you lay this down to dry, you'd like it to be as level as possible, because otherwise the mold turns out crooked when you flip it over to work on it. It's draining off to one side. Now I'll just babysit this for a little while as I go along. See up here there's a couple. And I'm probably going to have to mix some more. I see I'm getting a little short here. This part of the crutch we're probably going to wind up cutting off anyway, so I want to concentrate on that front part. Yeah, it looks like we're going to need two mixes. But when we're done, we should have a mold that we can make an infinite amount of parts on if we use enough care and release agent. We can loan it out to people, and like I said, our original one is still on loan. We still don't have it back. Somebody must have gone in a crutch business.
We'll not mention any names.
Anyway, I'm going to need more, but I'm just going to putter around, get this to go in all the corners, and as the air bubbles come up, pop them.
Thing, now that the mold is filled, low heat tends to pick up the bubbles. This is more for cosmetics than for reality. And then I got to be careful that I get this laying nice and flat, because otherwise when I go to make the mold again, the mold will be built like an alpine house. It looks like we're going to get most of them up. But that mixing, boy, that is the first time your mold doesn't cure, oh man, and boy is it a sloppy job getting the plug out sometimes. Lessons hard learned. Anyway, this is just about ready. We'll put this aside to dry overnight.
You can see where we've stored it, right under a molding, right under a heating vent. And that'll sit there 24 hours before we touch it. You can see the bubbles are already rising to the surface, even though we've done everything we can to get rid of them. We just hope none wind up on the part.
Now, you may think all we ever do is make molds and torture peeps, but you're not exactly right. Peeps, we have work to do today. Today is a very special day. We've been waiting all year for this. We're going to, let me just show you. Take a break from modeling for 1 minute. Yep. All right, Art Nowski. You're not playing with your molds anymore. Go upstairs and wallpaper. Everybody knows we have a 100-year-old house, and we're in the middle of setting up some wallpaper. And if you think my talents extend into wallpapering, you're wrong. What am I, in the top 5 wallpapers?
I'm learning. It took me 2 hours to put up the first piece of wallpaper. Ah. Anyway, we're gonna we're taking a break. Our molds are drying. We're ready. A little break from modeling is always good. Now here we are. Boy, I could have molded up 10 bodies in the time this took to do. Believe me, this may look like a simple thing. It is unbelievable.
Number two.
And we already have. Hey, just in case you think we're gonna mold tomorrow. Nope, we got tons more, and it's all corners and edges and angles and things above, things below. And you thought the only thing he could do is mold carbon fiber fuselages. Karen really likes having a ladder in her living room. And our new furniture arrangement. So here it is. We only finished half of the wallpaper. I know you were thinking, what's he putting wallpaper on a video? You know why? Because you got to do something while these moles are curing. Look at how much we got to do, though. We got a whole nother floor of the house to do. But anyway, it is. And this is the reason we're kind of sneaking in here. People are already getting here for Craig's 25th birthday. Heard on previous videos how we set the smoke alarms off, and today was no exception. This is the reason Wendy never loses weight.
This is the vegetable
potato. Rob, it's your birthday next week. She's going to do it all over again, too. Yeah, it really is. It's Craig's 25th birthday. And as always, Karen has done a marvelous job of making a nice table setting. And we just thought you'd like to share a minute of that before we go back to molding. We're going back to the shop. I'm all wallpapered out. My fingers are bleeding. I'm ready. Happy birthday to you. Men in thongs. We had a great birthday party. I just wanted to share a minute or two of that with you. Our wallpaper job's about half done, and we're back in the shop. Now, this is the significant thing. This you can kind of figure out there's 6, 7, 8 projects all going on at the same time. First thing I want to do is come down. Now, this is the last coat. I put the red on this. What I want to do is I want to get the tape off of the part. I never like to let the tape sit on any longer than it has to be. I learned a couple of interesting things about the carbon fiber. As far as taping and painting go, learned some things to do and some things not to do. The first thing that was interesting, I tried many different ways to get that first coat of clear on here, and the best way was to just sand it with 320 and get on a couple of coats of clear to fill in and seal all the little parts. But you can see what's happened. You can see it's imprinted right in some of the colors. Some of the colors it doesn't. When it's imprinted like this, it's that the paint has a little bit too much thinner in it. The white and the red, I thickened up the paint so that wasn't a factor. Another thing, where the two pieces come together in the trailing edge, you can see it's a problem. So what I'm going to try to do now, and I thought this would be a trick, I won't even do this on camera because it's time consuming, but we'll find out if it works, is I'm going to take, first off, the pens that I was using, the Sharpie pens, didn't work as well as I thought. The ink kind of bled when the clear hit it. You can see it looked good for a while, and then it bled. Well, I didn't like that. So what I'm going to do is the normal ink we use, normal India ink for Mylar that we do ink lines with, I'm going to make a real fine ink line right along the trailing edge, maybe a 16th of an inch thin, because I'm going to leave this showing just as a, I don't know. I'm still not sure I like this, but when I hold it up to the plane, it kind of has a nice look. Anyway, some of the little spots you can see here. Whenever you see these little spots where it kind of looks, if it picks up the impression of the carbon, In the final coats of clear, that'll go away, but it really does give you some anxiety. I thickened up the paint, the red was thick, and it came out perfect. So that's a good little tip you can use if you're going to paint something made out, and of course, we've done quite a bit of painting over carbon fiber. So this came in the mail today, along with a tremendous box of goodies. I don't need to put them all, but the two significant ones, and these are really good, from John Gunn, our friend in Texas, John Gunn. And he found this bit, and we'll keep this, I don't know what they, oh, it's quick load, it's because it has a shank here. But what he's using these for, the purpose of this is to cut the cowl opening vents with a perfectly round cut. Now I'm going to try this on some plywood and whatever next time I need. Actually, I want to try to cut some carbon holes. It is really a bear to cut carbon when you're cutting that plate. And how convenient is this? This just came at the time we're ready to start putting fuselage formers and crutches together. We'll see if we can find some use for that tool. That's from John Gunn. And I thought, well, I got this big box with stuff, and John is always, every time he watches a video, he figures some way of giving me some little present. Found these scissors. Now, I looked at the scissors and I said, man, these look like kid scissors. They're not, they're surgery scissors. And if you look at the blade, look at the blade real carefully. I don't know if you can see this. Well, one of the things I've always had a problem with is cutting fiberglass. If you always look back, I'm always having trouble. And I said, in his note, he said, these are the sharpest scissors he's ever seen. But boy, you can't imagine how sharp these are. Unbelievable. And these came from John Gunn. Now, you never know where you're going to pick up some good information. And John, and just in case, I got to show this on camera. Just in case they ever get dull, he sends me 30 more pairs. Oh, man. John, you are a great guy. Anyway, that came in today's mail. Terrific. I appreciate it a whole lot, John. Just as a point of reference, because I was making up a batch of wheel pants today, I wanted to see just how sharp these really are. And see, you never know when you're going to find a tool or a thing that just works perfectly. I mean, this is just, I don't know how long these are going to last, because these are probably not made to cut to cut fiberglass. They're probably made for some other application. But just let me give you an idea of how this works. Because if you're cutting carbon, especially carbon, you get about 10 cuts and the scissors are... A lot of scissors, they don't seem, they cut nice in the beginning, but they don't seem to last. Now these are ones that seem to be the best ones I had. Well, we're going to see. Anyway, these are really sharp. Cutting the cloth itself on these projects is such a pain. You can feel how this is cutting. It really cuts nice. Anyway, we have a new little part in our arsenal. And again, thanks to John Gunn, I really do appreciate this stuff. I always say how much I enjoy working with other people that are trying to do carbon fiber work. This is one of the RC people that's been... Well, we've exchanged ideas, exchanged phone calls. He's sent me some ideas. I've sent him some ideas. We've talked at length about different ways of doing things, even though he's in a different part of the event. In fact, two parts of the event. Terrence Mahady, and he's in the New Orleans area. He's a professional musician. And this is one of his RC pattern chips that he made as an original mold or original part. He made a carbon fiber canopy. Now here's the plane ready to fly, and what's interesting to me is how much, well, how many things there are in the world of pylon even, or RC pattern, where we could exchange the information. And I actually, this is one of the parts of doing this that makes it all worthwhile. One of his other projects with a plastic canopy, these are RC pattern ships. I don't know this. I wonder if these take big four strokes. There's a bunch of pictures here of a boat. He was working on a trimaran. Some of the different parts of the fiberglass work from this. And what's interesting, yeah, let's see. I see where this is all put there. This is from a kick-up rudder. But again, it's the parts that you can share. And when you learn something, oh, look at this. This is cool. You know, this is really funny. I'm looking at pictures. Here's the exact can of resin we were using to make cowlings. In the very beginning, the West resin. Heat lamp. Same fan I have, in fact. Working on this. This must be, it looks like about a 20-foot boat anyway. Some of the other work, they made some special rudder. It looks like, I don't really understand much about boating at this level. But some of the fiberglass work inside, you can see how to work. If they're using West Systems resin, is really a, oh, here's a picture of the whole boat. Oh yeah, it's not a model boat. Or else it's a very big model boat. Anyway. Look at this. Now that is, see when you, what's nice is again, it's just that exchange of information. Here's a picture of Terry standing in front of his work of art boat. Now, it is a lot of fun exchanging the ideas, doing the phone calls and everything, but this is what I really like. And this is always what makes it all worthwhile. He says, Wendy, you know, one thing about you, you're a nice guy, but every time I watch one of your videos, the music in the background stinks. He hates this music. He hates it. He says, you got to play this music. Look at this. He sends me his there. Of course, he's a percussionist. That is. And here's his card. Terry, we really do enjoy it. We hope you're learning on gaining some information on what we're doing. We're learning from what you're doing. I think that's half of the fun. Say thanks a whole lot. We'll send you some tapes to keep you company. Just one final thought. I'm playing Terry's tape here. Check it out. And what I think about in times like this is Craig is a big jazz fanatic. I'm going to make him a copy of the tape for you. He'll tell me if you know what you're doing when it comes to carbon fiber tape. And I mean, see, I don't know anything about jazz. I don't know anything about music. What am I talking about? Anyway, Terry, again, thanks a whole lot. And today, too. Boy, mail is heavy today. From John Grigsby. And John, of course, is doing carbon fiber experimenting. And he made those really nice carbon fiber wheel pants. I think Bob Gieske was using them last year. I'm not sure. He had sent me a pair, and they were really beautiful. Now, one of the things he noticed, and he's done a lot of little experiments and sent me copies of the experiments. He's been watching a lot of videos, so he probably knows more than we do right now. It looks like he had some carbon fiber reinforcements in here. This is Roacell, and you can bend it. See, this, I'm just wondering. This is the thing I don't know. Now, maybe I know John is going to see his video, so this is one of the things I don't know. You can heat and bend it like you do a prop, but I wonder if you could take a flat piece and heat it into an airfoil. Once it was all laminated, put it into some kind of a mold and heat it and make an airfoil, and when it cooled, if it would assume that shape, that'd be an interesting test to do. Well, this would even be interesting if you could get this to lay flat and assume the shape and then put some carbon on the inside. I'm not sure. He's using the same material we're using, but what's handy too, John documents everything that I can keep in my little list of things. This is a piece of 3/8 triangle balsa. It looks like, now see, he hasn't even seen the video where we made our version of the elevators. And he's already invented something. Well, he might have invented it before us. Who knows? But it doesn't matter. We don't, not on some Christopher Columbus kick here. He put the little edges on. Now, I'm just curious, you know, how this would accept paint once you sanded it down. He's got the resin really tweaked out because you can see there's even the little dry spots in there, which is good, by the way. That's what makes it light. Going through all the details, is there's a lot of release things here, things that I want to keep. See, what I do whenever I get a note from somebody like this, I have a file and I keep it on as a reference. I get these from Ed Gallagher, from, well, John, another one. Several people that have tried things, done an experiment, sent me a sample, and this way we can kind of combine our efforts. So somewhere, I understand Dan Winship's working on a carbon fiber wing, so somewhere down the road, if everybody comes up with one little piece of the puzzle, you'll eventually have it. And the problem is, like anything else, there's just so many possibilities here that it's mind-boggling how many things you can do with carbon fiber once everybody puts their little piece of the puzzle in. The sample, he's doing exactly what I'm doing, making press samples. And the problem with, this is Roacell, the problem with doing any of these things with unidirectional is, and he mentioned this in his letters, and these are sample for, see how quick that breaks? See if you don't have anything going in the other direction. Now on a carbon fiber landing gear, it's exactly the opposite because it's much thicker, and when you make the weave, you intermingle with the fibers, you get a lot more strength because you have all the strength. In other words, if you have a landing, let's say this is a landing gear, you have all the strength going in this direction. You don't need any strength going in this direction. So if you use weave in a landing gear, it's kind of like half of it's just going along for a ride. But in this case, this would be a problem. If you made an elevator, I can anticipate that might be a problem. But again, he's already come across the same exact thing. Now, we don't know. See, I don't know if there's a way of getting around this. There probably is. And he has this half-ounce fiberglass. The half-ounce fiberglass isn't going to do a whole lot when you have something as strong as carbon. It's like having a cement wall and a piece of paper wallpaper on one side. The wallpaper isn't going to do much. It's the cement that's got to do the work. Here's some parts that John reinforced with little reinforcements. See, now this, I'm not sure this would be strong enough for a wing. For a tail, if you could come up with a way of, and I'm already looking at this. See, he's got two of these here, a nice big one too. If you could come up with a way of doing this, joining it over a form, I'm not sure. But I know, it's tricky, but you know what? You don't go to the moon because it's easy, you go because you're crazy. He said here the toe did not work, the Roso warps, like balls are with dope on one side. Well, okay, but I don't know how else you could learn. There's fiberglass cloth on one side too. I know the elevators we made, see, John didn't see the video of my elevators when I made. I didn't see this before, or I would have. See, if I would have seen this, I would have said, hey, voila, home for you all. This is nice. I think these elevators are usable. But again, the trick here is we're trying to get a little bit lighter carbon, and somewhere in the world we're going to find that a source for that, and then we're going to be really home for you all. This is, for all purposes, this is 3-ounce carbon. Problem is it's just a little too stiff, and when you get down lower than 3-ounce, it's all unidirectional. But we're going to find it. Elliot's working on this in England. He's going to try to find us a source. He actually went to the place where they weave the carbon fiber and spoke to the guy. So we're going to find out, you know, if that's going to be doable, practical, whatever. Well, too, he sent me some Roacell. Ed Gallagher had sent me some. It's a really dense foam. I'm sure there's something. We just don't know exactly what to use this for yet. But I'm going to save the samples. I'm sure we're going to find something. See, it's just Roacell 51. What I'm going to do is put all these experiments in one pile, the Roacell pile. And I know when John sees the next tape with the elevators on him, I know what's going to happen is he's going to be laughing. We're both crossing the Atlantic here in two canoes and yelling back to each other. But we are getting to the other side. And John, believe me, I will keep this and I will read it. And that release agent stuff that you're talking about, I sent you some Teflon. I sent you some of the other stuff, the bleeder cloth, as you requested. Let me know how that all works out. Get back to our composite project. Some of the things we experimented with, we're ready to pull that crutch mold apart. I prepped up the mold again. We're going to run another part if we can find enough material. We have those little belly pans to run today. And we're going to try to run this, pull the mold apart. I want to let that dry till, well, as late into the day as possible because it's been drying overnight, of course. And I'll pull this apart. And we should be able to make a crutch today. What's nice about working on several projects at once, there's always something in silver, always something hanging up drying, always something you're experimenting with, always something you're painting, always something you're working on. There's always something new to try, new to test,
new to work on, and that's what I like about doing this kind of, by the way, here's our tail, John. As I'm saying this, I don't know, I think your elevators look better than mine, but it's all in the eye of the beholder right now. We have work to do.
Oh God, today our luck has gone from bad to worse. They're predicting 10 inches of snow. Ugh. Anyway, what I wanted to do, I wanted to lay up at least one crutch just to get one going today. Boy, I was thinking I'd have a whole day in the shop, and it's going to be a whole day behind a snowblower here.
It's a winter wonderland. Oh, God. I just can't believe it. Just when you think you can get some typhoon things done. Oh.
Hey, the only interesting thing happened today. Had a long conversation with Lyle Larson, the pylon guy. He's going to have me mold up some tune pipes for the Pylon World Championships to supply the team with Lyle's tune pipe, which he's designing. Jimmy's going to do the mandrels, and I'm going to do the manufacturing of them, so we'll be looking forward to seeing if if we can make something they can use in the world of pylon, that'll certainly add to my knowledge of the event. Anyway, not a great day, but we will try to get a crutch laid up.
I am so sick of shoveling snow. Now what I'm going to try to show on this, we have this, of course this has been drying. Usually the easiest way to get this off is just to, in this case it won't break, but just trim it, trying not to cut as much of the rubber as possible. See if I can get this to break away. Well, sometimes the wood pops right away. In this case, it isn't, so. But I'll just take it off in chunks, little by little, because I don't want to cut any more of the rubber out. Oh, look at this. I lied.
I don't even have to.
Let's say, as long as I can get one corner up. It's been sitting there. You came a long way from St. Louis. Now, to keep in mind what I want to do, I want to save the part, and I'll explain why. I want to save the plug up in my little collection of things. It's a miracle that this is coming out. Anyway, really, I seriously did talk to Lyle, and making some tune pipes for the pylon guys is going to be a fun, adventurous thing, because their requirements, of course, are totally different. See, this piece of wood came out, but I'm not worried about the box. I really would like to learn more about the other events. Baby, you've got a
long way to go. Been able to add one mold to our collection of crutches that we can mold, and I gotta go answer the door. The reason I wanted to save this is I wanted to be able to at some future time, let's pretend we want to make a crutch just like this for an engine that has a smaller dimension here. All I need to do is, I can lay in a couple of pieces of 64th plywood. For that matter, I could lay in some masking tape if I wanted to. Or I can make other modifications to this. And I purposely made it longer than it'll ever, it's 10 inches long, so it'll fit a wide variety of planes. So this becomes now a permanent part of our collection of tooling that we can use to make crutches. Yeah, this is what I mean about, you see the evolution of how things have worked out here, and we save all the plugs, because again, we may want to go back and use one of the older ones, or we want to at least see how these work and how they've evolved over the years. Trying to trim all these extra little rubber edges off. Actually, probably easier with a razor blade. I'm just trying to find uses for these scissors. Boy, these things are razors. Anyway, that's pretty much ready to lay up a part now. Then I put a little bit of that silicone spray release, even though you don't really need it with this. This is going to be the first pull on a mold. What I want to do is pre-cut all the material. We're going to use EPON 862, the same
resin system we used on a fuselage, but I want to try to get as much of the toe that one piece connects everything together. The idea is not to use little pieces. Up here, I want to put a little bit of the weave going back and forth so that the, because we're going to actually drill and tap this. No blind nuts. And I want to get as much of the toe with as few joints as possible that I can possibly get in here. So I'll cut all that material up ahead of time, mix the resin, and we'll be ready to lay this up.
Okay, we've got all the material pre-cut, and we're just doing estimates of how many short pieces we need, medium, long. I'm trying to make a notation of this, so if I run out of one longer or shorter, I'll just cut some more up. There's plenty of time to lay this part up. I put it on a piece of glass, which I wanted to show here. It's on a piece of glass so that I can take the whole thing and put it up by the heating vent or somewhere where it'll be warm. I also have a sheet of heavy Teflon to lay on top of here. And this is held in place with two pieces of wood. What that does, it keeps it from bowing or in some way distorting, because we want to keep nice straight parallel lines on this, of course. Next thing is I'll mix up the EPON with the Haloxy modifier. I use EPON with the Haloxy 68 modifier in a 90 to 10 ratio, and then use 87 parts of that resin mix to 13 parts of Epicure to make my resin system up. This is all on the previous video, similar, exact same resin system as the fuselage, and it will have to be post-cured over at George's shop, 212, for 2 hours. And that's the system we've come to really respect as the ultimate in strength, lowest weight of all the systems we've tried. I save all the scraps of carbon. I never throw any scraps away, just keep a big box. Because right now I want to make some pieces to go in here where the bolts are going to go. The weave would serve the purpose of, in this case, the purpose is so that a bolt can't split it in any one direction. And I'll just make a bunch of paper dolls up that'll fit this piece. And basically I can even make some up from here. Can make them all up from scrap. Yet I made up a little pattern. Ooh. And I dropped the little pattern. And I'll save the pattern. And the idea is to get each layer of carbon to have the weave in just a little bit different direction. That's why I wouldn't want to start at one end and just make them all the same. I'd like to get some with the weave cross. Because each time I do that, I'll be strengthening the part up. I wanted to try this just for my own satisfaction. Cutting that Kevlar thread is always a problem with Dull scissors. Boy, how this cuts. This is unbelievable how sharp these scissors are. And I'll make up about 20 or 30 of these just to pack the mold with, just like little paper dolls. Ready to start the layup. Little parts cut. But the same rules apply that we've been using all along. When you think the EPON is mixed, mix it 2 minutes more. In this case, what we're trying to achieve is to get the most resin squeezed out of here so that the ratio of toe or weave to resin, that there's more toe than there is resin weight-wise. We're below 50%. And we know the only way we can do that is to really pack the mold, really get it packed in all the edges and corners, get as much carbon and as little resin as possible. Now I'm just going to do the rest of this. Off camera, we're going to start laying pieces in this. We're going to start with a very simple, the easiest area of all is up here in the front, and try to pack in a bunch of these, the little paper doll pieces that I've made, making sure each one is soaked with resin, packed up into the corner as much as possible. Again, I want the joints. I want all the joints not to line up. That's the whole objective. Get each joint line. If you've ever done masonry work, you know you don't want all the joints in the bricks to line up together, or you have a stress riser. And probably the building would come falling down. Anyway, we'll let the camera run a few minutes
every few minutes, even though this is about a half hour layup because I really try to get the stuff packed in. This is one part where, imagine there's going to be an engine thumping along on this, no matter what engine you use. It's going to take a beating, this part, and it's going to have the threads to the motor in it, so we're just going to lay piece after piece after piece, packing all the corners and edges every step of the way. What I'm going to lay the toe pieces in, and this is 50K toe. I'm trying to lay it in. Again, the objective is to pack it and overlap the joints so no two joints are on top of each other. Get plenty of resin in there so there isn't any hint of a dry spot, and then constantly squeezing and manipulating it out. And answering the phone just at the 1 minute in a layup that you don't need a phone call. President Nixon calls. One of the little tricks that I've learned. See, I'm trying to get the same piece to go in with as few joints as possible. Is get it to go around the corner. Wet. Do a good wet down on it. And then what I try to do is using a trowel. I don't know if I can get this on camera. Using the trowel, get it down in there. See, now by having one piece, we're building strength this way. There's no two joints going across on the same side. And because these things are so thin, it's hard to get the 50K toe to pack down in there, but it'll pack. Yeah, I'm excited about working on this project with Lyle Larson. He has just been such a great guy, so helpful. He's already made arrangements with Jimmy Snyder to work on his tune pipe project, and we'll do the manufacturing once Jimmy does the tooling. Should be a lot of fun. Should be a good job. Loading this all up, packing it all, it's overflowing in every dimension. And I'm trying to squeeze out as much of the extra resin as I can, and I don't know how much is going to come out, but I'm going real slow. I put a sheet of Teflon so you can see some of it oozing out of there. A sheet of this thick 16th inch Teflon. Then I'm going to put another weight on top of this, something flat. Hopefully keep it flat, but we're going to grind it anyway, and even if we have to, we can put it in a milling machine. The idea is to squeeze out as much resin as possible. And get as much of the crisscross, the weave, all the joints not lined up. Again, the roller is just here to roll it until we can get something flat on top of this. Here is to clean up the tools with some alcohol, ordinary isopropyl alcohol. And of course, put some weights on that. We'll let it sit overnight. Another piece of the terrible Typhoon has been pieced together. 24 hours, I'll let it sit in that mold. Get all the epon off of the tools. And it's time to go shovel more snow. Basically, I'm going to sit there overnight, being compressed with as much of the extra resin squeezed out as possible. As you probably know, ours is not the only Typhoon being built. Elliot Scott is building one, and so is Walt Brownell. And Walt Brownell has sent these pictures of his. It's all wood, no silt span. Just have an elevator built like Miss Ashley, except heavier. Heavier? Walt's supposed to be lighter. A 7-pound wood. That looks like a big tail. Anyway, these are pictures. I'm going to go right through these. Walt Brownell is doing an incredible job. Now, he is a master scale builder, too. Remember, he flies scale as well as stunt.
And just check some of this technology out. He's going to have a four-stroke in it, of course. This is where he has kind of an Al Rabe thing, where he tapes the whole thing together to get the look. Walt, I need to know what kind of canopy you use. You got any idea for a canopy here? Send me some information. He's got molded top, bottom. That rear is carved from light. Yeah, the bottom's kind of flat. Now this is important. Fuchsia's extended tank box. General Champ's probably interested in that. Cowl is carved but is removable without removing exhaust. Now see, I like the way he did that. That is slick. Now see, Walt, you beat me to the punch. I don't know how mine is. And I don't know if I'm going to have to take that off to get the exhaust off. We don't know yet. It's a challenge. The next challenge. But Walt's obviously ahead of us here in construction. He's got the engine mounted. The servo, remote glow. I like the remote glow driver too, that's nice. Set up for Funfly, Bill Young's system with servo for throttle and another servo for bomb drop. These will be removable for Pampa Stunt. Anyway, we're all doing some electronic tests and Walt, I am totally impressed. I hope you're going to get some really good photos of this so we can get them in Stunt News. Appreciate it a whole lot, Walt. Hey, keep sending the photos. Also in the mail, some nice pictures from Ed Captainelli of his Cavalier. Looks like he either made or bought one of the Tom Morris kits. And Ed's supposed to be up here in the spring. Anyway, another thing here I'll show in the next photo. Ed's got kind of a Joe Adamusco rack, for lack of a better word, shop. Hey, Ed, we really look forward to seeing you up here. This is from our friend Dave Rays. He's in Maryland. He's been watching a lot of videos trying to pick up on the finish. What he's interested in is heat. By the way, he says since, I'm reading the caption, since added the half ribs. Also, and this is the part I like, he sent me a really nice note. He's doing up a Cobra, and he said for the first time in his life, he's felt that beautiful, smooth, silvery, powdery Brodak dope finish. And he's really happy about it. He's been watching video after video. I imagine it's only a matter of time. And hey, we're going to see you at the local contest this year. That looks like it's going to be a nice plane. Anyway, it's really nice when somebody does pick up on some of this little information and they can add to their enjoyment of the hobby. As you know, I get a lot of European magazines, and this one is one of the better ones. I get them from Paul Winter. He sends me this one. Of course, it's got a biplane on the cover. An elite plane with a carbon fiber prop on an electric motor. And I'm just sitting here reading it, and I say, holy crow, I know that girl. And there she is, Amy Spangler. And Paul wrote this thing. I guess it's we'll read it before we pass it on to Amy. Amy, of course, was a lot of fun at last year's Nats. Paul did his little dissertation here. And a quick plug for some of the sources in England for getting materials. He says he didn't learn a single thing from the videos. He didn't even learn how to make a set of ribs right. Looks like he's got my plates there, though. Anyway, Paul, I'm glad to see you having some success and some fun. And I will forward the magazine off to Amy. Amy, hey, if I had it my way, you'd be on the cover, sweetheart. And Paul would be, well, we'll leave that for another magazine. Anyway, from Paul Winter, and Paul, it is a good article. Believe it or not, I'm impressed. Okay, back to the shop. We've had enough mail and enough snow, enough wallpaper. Oh. Now this morning, I'm not sure if this is ready to demold. A Teflon piece, so you can still see the impression of the resin in there. But we could clean that. These parts can be cleaned, by the way, with a little bit of alcohol and a rag and used over. I want to pull this out, and it's easier. Oops.
it's easier to find what I call peel back rather than trying to tear it out. It's like those little exhaust manifolds. You need to really, whoops. See what I'm doing? I'm trying to pull a mold back real carefully. You can see how this is coming out. Whoops. Oh. Now we got to run over to George's and put this in his oven to post cure at 212. The reality is you don't have to post cure this. You could post cure this at some time in the future, but I just want to get it post cure. I feel like I'll have a better shot at working with it. Actually, it looks pretty good. And then, of course, once we get it post cured, we'll grind it all, get the flats on it and everything. But before I use the mold again, I'll put the release agent in there. Next thing I'm going to do is make Elliot Scott his crutch so we can kind of, while I have the material and I'm, my little technique is down. Look at this, I got a little piece of tape in the mold too. It's a little piece of tape, it's in there, it's not going to make any difference. But you can see how nice that came out. A lot of good interconnecting and we'll be able to tap that for the motor bolts. And that's the first piece out of our crutch. I think that's a part that anybody can make. We're going to run over to George's now while this is in the oven. Just hang out there, because by the time we, the 2 hours, it needs to be cured at 2 hours at 212. Mounting pads and everything. No more new rocket ships?
Yes, actually there is one.
Everybody liked that rocket ship on the video, boy. You know what, that'd make a great, that looks like a hood scoop I made for my 52 Dodge out of a box of oatmeal.
Actually, I made the mold for this,
man.
And a friend of mine took it to where he was, because they have a big vacuum former, mine won't fit this.
Yeah, yeah.
And he told them it was an airboat bottom, which is really not.
Yeah.
It's the bottom to the model of a shuttlecraft from Star Trek, from the first.
Here we go. Thank you. For people who missed that on the video, here's his, the Star Trek 1 or whatever the hell
that
is.
That's Fireball XL5.
Oh, man. That is a piece of work, my friend. All molded construction. No more new projects going on here? My milling machine, he babysits my milling machine here. I don't get to spend much time here since we've been on the internet. The internet has made the business grow to where I hardly ever come down here. Anyway, it is a great place to do modeling, drafting, vacuum forming, welding, you name it, we can do it right here in the shop. Uh-oh, he's got something, uh-oh. Star Trek 3 coming out.
Star Trek.
Oh, no.
The latest. This is going to have rotating lights, lights on the console, working doors.
This looks like
open.
Something from the Space Odyssey.
This is from, but I'll go get the other pieces if you want.
Space Odyssey. And that's the base plate there that you had vacuum for?
I'll get the one that I cut out. That's a spare one.
It's a wonderful place to be. This used to be at one time Ken Thompson's when he was in the foam cutting business. He's out of that business now, and there is just oodles of cool, about 250 sets of plants. All kinds of cool stuff going on here. I think the only place cooler is John Brodak's shop. Yeah, I just demolded that fuselage. I know what you're talking about.
Oh. This is just quarter inch plywood. There's three supports down through here.
So it's a plug.
Built
it's a plug
oversized,
for the vacuum former.
Oversized in this direction and in this direction. From that, this gets molded.
Okay.
Okay, this was the first pull, kind of webbed.
Yeah.
So I pulled the second one, which I then trimmed down to this, which will get trimmed even further.
Yeah.
The back gets cut off of this.
How thick is that material? Eighth inch?
Well, we started out with 3/16, by the time you pull it.
Yeah, it thins out.
Works out to about 120.
Yeah.
That fits in here. Or the bottom, however.
Yeah. Interesting project.
That's where it starts. I got one more thing to show you.
Light.
So, what I'm going to do is there's actually another plate that goes over here, which is a mirror. And that fits over these LEDs, which are replaceable.
Yeah, yeah.
Because there, some of them are in series. But then that is going to go on here. Okay? This all fits inside of this tube, which will eventually be longer. It'll be this full length.
Mm.
And then that fits inside there. Okay? Mm-hmm. And then there's a dome.
And it'll give the appearance that it's rotating.
And then what happens is the facets of this flatten out the spokes, and these will fire one here, and then the next three, and then the next three, next three.
Yeah.
This one will stay on constantly, and it has a really nice effect. It looked really good until I took my voltage regulator and pumped 45 volts into a volt and a half circuit. Then they stopped working really fast. Once the smoke comes out of an electrical device, it stops working anymore.
Once they smoke, the dumpster time.
These doors will open this way, actuated by a motor up here. This lower section of the door drops down, hopefully.
Cool.
Hopefully it goes back up too. Or when you press a button, all electronically, from outside a case, similar to the other model over there. There'll be those LEDs
Through
there, and that fits.
Yeah.
It fits, it's just a real tight fit. It fits on there and all goes inside.
Pretty cool.
So, I don't know how well that photographs on a silver background.
Anyway, when it's at its completion, we'll add it into our things that we've shown. George, I'm still impressed with the rocket. You won every show, huh?
Well, one of them I came in second. But God. I don't know how I did it. I came in second place but got best of show.
Yeah, I've done that. I've been in the second row and won the concourse. I don't know how that works.
I don't know. I'm not sure.
Yeah, that nose cone rotates every time I move this because it's only held on with magnets.
Yeah, yeah,
I
saw that.
See, it's spinning, so I have to reach it.
Next step on this now. This has been post-cured. It's like glass now. It's rock hard. So the first thing I want to do is I want to trim off. This whole piece was only on here to act as a piece to get some pressure down in here and squeeze out the extra resin. So the first thing I want to do is go over to the belt sander and trim this all off until I only have the actual part that I'm going to use.
Really flat. This is the mold, and this is the side we're going to use. This side we just want to sand through until I can get that cloth out, and it's just picking up the high spots right now. Actually, you're starting to see the parts come through. Then you have to be very, very careful. You're at that flat surface. You can start punching the parts out.
Next thing, now that the belt sanding part is done, I want to take this over to the sink and take one of my Bud McKnight sanding sticks and deburr everything. I don't want any sharp edges on this part. What happens with a sharp edge is that it's always a place a crack can start. So just like polishing connecting rods on an airplane, you want to polish as many of these edges and areas as I can. And best to do that wet, or you can see what happens. Your hands get all black, and you wind up, the more you can sand wet, the better it is.
Like any carbon fiber sanding, by the way, these sanding sticks, they're really nail files. They work exceptionally well
wet. And again, it's just the same way as you would polish a connecting rod. You don't want any razor edges. A razor edge is a spot for a crack to start. And since we anticipate having a long service life, we hope, the question is, and then we're gonna do a little cone fit of the motor here. See, once the part is post-cured, then it's real nice to work on. It sands and grinds and everything is nice. Before you post-cure it, it's a little on the glassy side. And we're going to trim the back of this off, so we really don't even know how much of this we're going to use, but we try to make it as universal as possible. And we still don't know which is going to be our final choice of motors, but we're trying to make this whole nose section as universal as possible. Now, the next step in this, we need to put a little half moon in here so that the motor sits right down in there and we have clearance for the carburetor. The carburetor is going to come right up the back. And you can see, if you look from the front, I purposely made this oversized so I could put this little angle in there. And I need to do this, let's see if we can see it. Yeah, just that little angle, because what it'll do, it'll leave me a little extra motor mount material here for when I want to put any of the other motors in, the motors that have a little bit smaller case mount. Okay, now I know how far the case goes back to here and up to here. These are the two dimensions. I need to just take that little half moon out with a Dremel tool. And by having the tape on here, it'll just make it easier than actually marking the carbon fiber. What we need to do is just half moon this out. And what this does, it lets more of the motor mount material. If we just made thinner mounts, we wouldn't have enough material around here. I want this whole piece to be nice and solid. The way those recesses worked in there, and what I did, I found a little nice little roll of I don't know, 80 grit sandpaper, 100, whatever it is, to get a nice cut on there, a nice finish. The next thing is going to be to lay out the engine mount holes. Now you can see that mounts perfectly straight. Room for the carburetor. It's going to be a real nice installation. Now I need to lay some tape out here and drill and tap the holes. Now I'll show you what my technique for getting some real accuracy in the motor mounts. Now if you have wood motor mounts, you can be off and the holes get sloppy because the bolts are going in on an angle and you just... But when you're doing carbon fiber, it's got to be pretty precise. So one of the things I found in making several of these that worked well, a good technique, is to lay some tape out on a carbon, make sure the motor is exactly where you want it. Make sure you have just a little bit of offset in it. And then what I want to do is drill and tap one hole. See how nice and tight that fits in there? So that sets my one hole. And once that's in, and I can hold the motor. See, what in the past, what I'd try to do is, just try to punch all the holes at once, then drill them, and then the bolts. You know, there's no room for something being not accurate here. So what I'm going to do is just take this one out, and you can see how convenient is that it puts that nice little spot. Pilot drill it. Drill it with the correct drill for a 632 tap, and then tap at 632. See, now I always take this. This is a smaller drill and drill a pilot hole to make sure I have it perfectly centered. Again, you need a lot more precision when you do carbon fiber. Now, if we were going to make several of these, I'd make a little horseshoe thing with the hole alignment. But I don't right now. Only making one. This is the only 91 I have, and these will be our permanent mounting holes. But having that little starter. Now, when that bolt holds it in, and that is such a good thing, then I can really get accuracy.
and it'll be like almost like a machine shop job where the bolts will drop right in. Remember, this is a 91. I'm looking to make this as absolutely bulletproof, but at the same time it's bulletproof, I don't want it any heavier. I don't want to just make the mounts 7/8 of an inch or something. I want to do it with precision. See how nice and accurate that is. Now what I do, I want to get the drill that I used before doing the 632 tap. These are 632 holes. Okay, number 36 drill. This is the correct drill for tap just before you tap on number 36. Secret to making this whole thing work is the fact that instead of a blind nut catching two or three threads, you're catching threads for the whole piece. This is the part that I think is a significant gain, even if you're making a wood crutch, and this is a great tip. See, now I can, well, this is a little bit too tight, but I can adjust my, if I want a little offset, in this case, I just want the slightest bit of offset. But now I can go with my sharp tubing. The tubing is a tight fit in the Sado mounts. And just, this makes for some really accurate motor mount bolts. But the secret is get one bolt in first. It's that whole thing we talk about of one part lining up the other part. And we want this part of it, I want this. This is the first time I'm setting up this type of a nose construction, so I'm over-engineering everything. This is the whole thing that makes it nice. Now you have real accuracy. Now you can go and take center with a center drill. Or pilot hole them even better. Then take your number 36 drill and then just tap them out. And that is one of the best tips, I think, for getting, there's nothing I hate more than having all these holes on angles and you go to tighten the bolts and they don't tighten. This is just such a nice way to do it. The tricks to drilling carbon fiber that I've found is, number one, it eats drills up, so you just basically get 10 holes drilled and you throw the drill away. The other thing is, the slower you can run the drill, the better. The worst thing to do with a carbon fiber part is put a drill in that's sharp and run it fast, at a fast speed. So what I try to do is run it extremely slow. We're on the slowest speed that this drill press will give. Then I try to just put my little pilot hole in, make sure I've got it centered. And constantly back the drill out, constantly back the drill out. Constantly back it out, let it clear the chip. Don't try to push down and run the drill through in one shot. I mean, this is a little bit different technology than using wood parts. The motor mount itself is holding the bolts, and the bolts are actually holding it in alignment. So they're doing a lot of things that you don't realize they're doing, but this really does work well. We have really had good luck with this system. Just a couple of thoughts about the taps. I just use ordinary taps, go about a turn or two, and then back out the chip. I don't try to just wind them up like a watch. Go, you can feel a lot of resistance. Carbon fiber is rough on tools, what you'll find out. It's rough on saw blades, rough on any kind of tooling. As soon as it starts feeling a bind, back the chip out. And I've found that by doing them dry, I seem to get a halfway decent cut. I tried using cutting oil. It didn't seem to work a whole lot better. But again, you're not going to, here it comes out the other side. Now, you're not going to get 40 or 50 or 60 holes drilled and tapped. But what is nice is you get such a nice tight fit on the bolts and you're catching all those threads. It's really the best of all worlds. Plus, number two, you're saving the weight of having long bolts. You don't need bolts that are 2 inches long either this way. So it's kind of a win-win. And once the holes are tapped, and just get rid of this. What I like to do is, if I was using blind nuts, what I would do is leave the bolts out and then shear them off. What I do is carefully measure, take the bolt out. It sounds like this might be not that important, and then dress the edge off,
make sure this is a chamfered edge. For the simple reason, if you have a burr on here, it's going to chew up the carbon fiber eventually. So, and shortening the bolts saves another couple of grains. Every step of the way here, we're getting a few gains back on things that normally you lose on. Now that is really the best setup I can imagine for this engine. That carburetor sits right in there. We have no extra bolts. No matter how I look at it, I'm real happy with this. Now, of course, some of this is going to be cut off. The only thing I'm going to have time to do yet tonight is I have a bunch of material. This is special material I've made up that I want to go through and look at to come up with the former and doubler material that are going to go on this crutch. That's the next thing. That's probably the only thing I'm going to get to do yet tonight. Now the next step is going to be I have to line up the nose, line up the formers, make up the doublers. It's a whole complicated thing and I don't want to split that up on a tape. But we do have one really request I'd like to fill. Is a lot of people have said, gee whiz, the tape ends and you like there's steps we still need to see on the next tape. So we have about 5 minutes left on this tape, and what I was going to do is put some footage from old Nats, and I have some footage of people that aren't with us anymore. And one of them is Bob Barron, and I have a memorable flight of his from the 92 Nats, and from the Nats footage we took that year. Again, I hope you enjoy it. I hope you enjoy the video. Please share it with your friends. For one, I play footage constantly in the shop. I'm always looking at old video, and it seems like once somebody passes away, that footage becomes priceless. Anyway, this is Bob Barron doing his thing at the 92 Nats, and we will see you on the next tape. Bob Barron's first official flight of the Nationals. You getting much footage, Jose?
Yeah, but you gonna tape this one?
Yeah.
I'll go tape something else.
Yeah, good.
You take this one and I'll take the other circle.
Yeah. Jose, there's a tripod in the truck if you want it too.
What is? Tripod in the truck if you
want it. Right under the front seat if you want to use it.
I haven't flown yet, so I don't want to get too steady.
This plane is affectionately known as the picket fence. If you crash, you just leave it there and it's part of the fence.
tell through the lens.
Looks like it could use a little more corner, that's for sure.
I hope you enjoyed that little flashback. You know, as time goes by, I don't know, it's sad, it's funny, I don't know. Friends I had my whole life, now that they're gone, I really do enjoy having the video of them and the time that we shared. Coming up soon, maybe on the next tape or two, Mike is ready to put the wing in the body of his Cardinal. Dave Midgley and Woody are coming down for a weekend. We haven't set a firm date yet. The field is almost melted, and we even intend to get out on a couple of cold days and use our Z-tron again. We're going to try to give the Y&S one more test day if we possibly can, two more test days, a couple more test days, I'm not sure. And there's just a load of things we're waiting to do. There's so many projects we're working on. I hope that you're picking up some information off of these tapes. I hope you enjoy these little segments with Bob Barron. I'm going to look for some footage of other people that I think, kind of got overlooked in the event, or I don't know, overlooked's not the right word, but that we don't see from day to day, or either because they're passed away or we just don't see them, period. Maybe they've dropped out of the event or whatever. But some interesting footage, old footage you might not have seen, especially if you're a new subscriber. And a real thrill, we're supposed to have Kent Tyser stay in a Spitfire bedroom next weekend. We don't know. They're going to deliver a plane for Larry Drouin, a real airplane. And we expect to entertain him. And he'll be one of our next guests in the Spitfire bedroom. Yeah, we're going to be looking for some real footage from the olden archives that you may not have seen.
And if you like that segment of the video, please let me know. And if you don't, we'll figure some other possibility out.